On November 25, 1917, Oscar Clifford Falken was born in Toronto, South Dakota. His parents, Gina and Knut Falken, were second-generation immigrants from Norway who raised 8 children on their homestead in Brookings County. Irvin, Morris, Hiram, Cliff, Vernon, Esther, Mavis, and Gladys all helped out on the farm. They milked the cows, plowed the fields, and fed the livestock, cows, pigs, and chickens mostly. At age 14, Cliff, as he was now being called, quit school to work at a dairy farm in Brookings, 26 miles away. Several years later, a Second World War called Americans to join Great Britain, France, China, Poland, Russia, and other allies in a war against Germany, Italy, and Japan. The U.S. started drafting men between the ages of 21 and 36 in 1940 for a war that would last 6 years and one day.
That's quite a story. That's when they started the draft. So 6 of us from Toronto here, we decided, why wait to get drafted? Because then they could put you in the plot. So we all went to Brookings and enlisted in the National Guard. Well, we had a little over 11 months in, and we'd have been out another 2-3 weeks, and then war broke out.
Wow.
So they went down to headquarters and they gave us a discharge paper at one desk, and on the way out, the guy sat there and put you in the regular army.
Oh my gosh.
Then you were stuck for the duration. Couldn't get out.
Wow. All 6 of you?
Yep. Well, it was me and my brother Hiram and Morris and cousin Kenneth Bierke, then his brother Andy, and it was Rob Woodall. Oh, and then, wait a while, there's another one. Was Clarence Walters from Clear Lake. Those original 6, it couldn't have been too bad because 2 of them got some of the top honors in the Army. My brother got the Bronze Star. Kenny Bierke was a, I'm not sure where that is. I think it's not too far down from the Congressional Medal of Honor, the Silver Star. So it wasn't too bad on the 6 guys. I went to Camp Claiborne, Louisiana. Then when war broke out, we went from there to New York. We got in a ship, headed for Ireland. We had to get prepared to hold. Oh, this is quite a story. War broke out the 7th of December, 14th of January. We was halfway across the ocean already.
Wow.
It was the first troops overseas. I never had 8 meal for 7.5 meals. We had 2 meals a day. I never ate a bite for 3.5 days.
Were you just nauseous?
Nauseous. You drank water and you throw it up. Well, this might sound kind of sickening, but went down to the tree in the ship and I was trying to throw up in the stool, and there's a sailor throwing up right alongside of me. And I said, do you get sick too? And he said, the first couple of days, but I love this weather. He said, I know there's submarines out there and they can't operate in these waves, 30-foot waves. So he was happy about it. I think he said they took pictures of 7 German submarines been out there waiting for us, but they couldn't do nothing.
Because of the weather?
Water's too rough. They couldn't operate. You know, and the funny part was, when we were walking down the street, there's German planes overhead, and we were so glad to get off that ship, we didn't care. And the English artillery was shooting at them. We didn't even hear it. Shells bursting, it was up to, quite a few thousand feet. But you should have known something was wrong, because in England, every town, on any air raid started, they dropped these balloons up just on a cable, you know, just froze. The Germans couldn't get down to town to hit them cables.
Oh, yeah.
When you saw those barrage balloons go up, you knew there was something coming. Well, we were getting training where we were going to land, you know, make a landing in Africa and get supplied and get new guns and new uniforms, new helmets. See, those are those old British World War I helmets. Yeah, so we got new helmets there. Then I spent about 6 months in the infantry. Glad to get out of there. We made a landing there. The Germans were in Egypt, and the British 8th Army went from the east, and we was coming from the west. We had them in between us. I think they come through Libya. Anyhow, we thought we had, do you ever hear of Rommel, the Desert Fox? He's supposed to be a great general. In fact, I wish he'd been our general. He was sharp. We thought we had him captured. You know, it'd been the feather in our cap. We found out he'd got back to Germany some way. He was closing in on him. The heat. He was on the desert burner all the time. And now I'm telling you, it was so hot there. Any vehicle, you had to cover the steering wheel with a blanket or jacket or something, because you couldn't touch it otherwise. And guys tried it, took a raw egg and broke it and put it on the hood of the truck. About 5 minutes, she's fried.
Ugh. And you guys slept in tents?
Yeah, in tents. No air conditioning. We got to one place on there. We were about 10 miles from the Mediterranean. We'd get up every excuse to get to go down there and swim. I and another guy with gas barrels he would haul. We'd haul them back to the gas company. So. Went up and told me, hey, we need a trip ticket. We got to haul gas barrels back. So they never looked. They signed the trip ticket and we took off. We had two barrels in the back. Just the Arabs, you had to watch them. They'd steal everything you had.
Really?
You know, I washed a pair of coveralls one time. It's kind of greasy and we used gas. And I hung it in a tree to air out. And I hadn't been gone 2 minutes, and I looked, and it was gone. And I could see under trees, and I couldn't see anybody anyplace. They'd run like a dog, or else cold if the Arabs wouldn't steal their blankets.
Oh.
You know, all these here nomads, they weren't like the ones in town. They were, to me, they were just a bunch of down-and-out people. And we'd lay with our heads inside the tent. You wake up and be cold, you know, it's got, on the desert, it got cold at night. You'd wear a big, heavy coat, and your blankets would be gone. So the only way you could fool them, we'd turn around with our heads the other way, and then we'd feel them, and they started pulling the blankets over your face. You'd jump up and grab the blanket, and the boy, they'd run like a son of a gun. When we first come over, the Germans had the superiority on airplanes. You could count on them coming over all the time, but towards last, right, we started building up with more planes, and then they didn't have any trouble with planes anymore.
Hmm.
Yeah, you drive down the road, you couldn't tell one that's going to come up behind you, you know, strafing down the road.
Mm-hmm.
As I and this other guy said, every fourth truck, see, would be a gun truck, and that was our job to keep the planes away.
Mm-hmm.
When they come down, I tell you, they respected those 50 caliber. When you start shooting at them, they said, oh, tracers start flying by their nose. They just, the way they go. Because they'd knock a plane down pretty easy. Well, I could have once, but I kind of goofed. That's kind of a long story. a plane come diving at our camp one night. And I was all ready to shoot, and I thought, oh, that's a Spitfire. I can't shoot that. That's a British plane. And he turned around, and he come back. He had British sign on the side. Mm-hmm. When he turned sideways, I could see the tail of the swastika on it. And I knew that was a captured British plane. So when he come diving, and I started shooting at him. And he got out of range, and I swung the gun. I fired some more shots, and I swing it again. By that time, he's out of range. After I got done, here come an officer over there, and he said, who's running his gun back here? And I thought he's going to give me heck for shooting at a friendly plane. I said, that was me. Well, what's the matter with you? He said, every time your bullets started eating into the plane, you'd quit shooting. And I said, well, I couldn't swing any farther to stop and swing the gun over. Well, he said, you'd come in from the back, and your bullets would start going to the tail of the plane, and you quit shooting. I didn't know that. But those 50 cal machine guns, you didn't sight or the barrel, you just have the grips and you just watch your tracer like a water hose. But you'd see every fifth one is a tracer.
Oh, okay.
You just see that line of fire, that's all you'd aim at, just where that was going, like a water hose. You just. We had red tracers and the Germans had green. When they shot, their bullets were green, see, and ours were red, and they'd go put back at them. We had them smoking sometimes. They'd come in diving around, but we'd be in trees and we'd wait to get up close and just let fly at them. I don't think some of them got back because it was pretty good smoke pouring out of the back end. Well, we didn't go out much during the day. We kept our trucks camouflaged. See, we'd done most of our work at night, moving troops and machine guns. Taking them, relieving guys up the front, bringing fresh troops up. One time we were so close, the guy said, be quiet, don't roar your motor. And I said, why? Listen, we could hear the Germans talking. Couldn't have been over 100 yards of windows from there. I was kind of headed to the convoy and I heard some artillery going off behind me. I didn't pay attention. Got back to camp and here Morris come in, my brother, and he always mad because I wouldn't wear a helmet. I just wore a little brown cap because a helmet bouncing, banging around your head. Mm-hmm. And he came in that night and he said he had 8 wheels on his truck and 5 of them had flat tires. The artillery had hit right by his truck. See, some dumb skunk had him. We come up down the road and it's called the Bailey Bridge. They were built up. And he saw the truck had him. He turned his lights on. Well, the Germans had all these bridges zeroed in, seen they saw lights on, they started firing. And Morris was just over the bridge when they hit. And he came back and he's telling me, he said, boy, it was close, a concussion knocked my helmet off. I said, let's see your helmet. And I said, are you sure it's concussion? And right up in here, you could see daylight. It didn't break through, but you could see where something had busted his helmet. You could just cracked, you can see a little tiny hole in there. You imagine if he wouldn't have his helmet on, it had it right in the forehead.
Was that a bullet?
No, shrapnel, this stuff I showed you. Oh yeah, it must have been just a small piece that hit his head, because been a big one, it knocked his helmet off. He said, well, it knocked it back on his head. It probably was a piece of shrapnel the size of a grain of sand or something.
So did you start wearing your helmet after that?
No. Went back for 2 weeks one time. We come back up to the front. Here about 5 miles, our division had really fought to gain that. The other division that took over, and right back we started, it backed up 5 miles. We first landed, see, we didn't know nothing about fighting. Crossing the desert, and here they come and said they'd lost control, the Germans were coming. And we was in a big cactus cab, about 30-foot cactus. And they said, they're bringing some trucks in to load up everything you can get out of here. And the guys that brought them in, they jumped on another truck and took off. They left the trucks there. So they said, load the gas first, leave the food for than he had done. They get in that room for the food, that great big heap of canned food. And he said, we're going to burn it. And they said, but don't burn it till daylight because the Germans are too close. They'll see the fire. Daylight, we burnt the fire to the pile of food and took off down the road of the gas. We got through a pass, and here they were lined up on the pass. We could see the guns sitting there, big guns, waiting for the enemy to come. And we said, who's behind us? And they said, Germans. Nobody else. We was the last ones out. We come out in the Stars and Stripes. There's 50-some people captured, not supposed to have been captured because they didn't think we was going to get out. We landed at Salerno Beach in Italy.
Okay.
Yeah, they got pretty rattled, got in there. Even the cooks are running around with rifles. Wasn't safe to walk at night, you get shot. The cooks didn't know how to fire a rifle, and they'd have a whole clip on top ready to push it in and start shooting. You should have saw the roads over in Italy. Just hanging alongside the mountainside, you couldn't drive with lights, you'd have blackout all night. There'd be trucks laying down the bottom, rolled over and smashed up. Well, you know, they had a little grade on the edge. We got so we could feel when the truck was going off, we'd quick turn back so you could drop down one side and we'd go the other way. And you couldn't go over too far because you'd hit the wall of the mountain on the other side. I know one night I was hauling some bridge equipment down to the river. I could hear them engineers, they were cool cats. And this one guy, I said, what's that noise? Oh, it's shells going off. And I said, what shells? Oh, the Germans are shooting at us. And I said, well, how come they're shooting over there? Well, they don't know exactly where we are. He said, they'll find a range pretty soon. And I said, get my truck unloaded. I'm getting out of here.
Yeah.
Didn't bother them any. I was going to shave. And I thought, well, I'll go down. I was going to go down and get the mail. And instead, I thought, I better shave first, because I had to get after you if you had over a couple of days' beard. And I couldn't get the stove to light, my cousin's stove, and it always worked perfect. I monkeyed around 10 minutes before I got that stove to light. Finally got going, I set my helmet on top, half full of water, got it hot, and I shaved. I suppose it took about 10 minutes longer than it should have. That's when I got through and I saw the bombs coming right at me. And after the next plane had dropped his, and I thought, he's heading right for headquarters. So I went down, I heard a bunch of hollering. Got down. I'd have been in the mail tent about then if I stole it to work, and the thing was just shredded. My best buddy got killed there, Harry Scolvin from Bruce. Not my best buddy, but he's a good friend of mine. They thought his, well, he got used to them. They thought his jugular vein was cut. So one guy jumped on a wagon and he held his throat shut to the hospital. And they got that fixed up and he died during night and they found out he had a piece of shrapnel on the back of his head. That's what killed him. That was the hardest thing that came home. Like Scoglin's folks, they knew I'd been in the outfit. And they all kept asking me what happened. That's the 34th Division. The Red Bull said our divisions spent more hours in the front lines than any division in the Army. I think it was 500 or 600 days we spent in combat. So we got to see a lot of stuff. A lot of stuff you didn't want to see. with 25,000 men just about that in the service. And I didn't know that, just reading in a paper that I got from somebody. You know how many replacements we had in them 3 years? 21,000.
No way.
Only 4,000 original company was left.
What is that?
Oh, that's a general from the 34th Division. The last thing we'd done in Italy, our division captured the German 34th intact. It wasn't a shot fired, we just encircled them and they'd give up. They said it's the first time it's ever happened that one 34th or one division the same name could capture another one in the army. Yeah, this is American bayonet. It's fit on the end of your rifle right here and here. It's kind of a nasty joke. It tells you your bayonet stuck, you couldn't get it out. Don't matter, don't bother about pulling, just pull the trigger.
Oh.
And here's a German officer's dress knife. I'm kind of proud of it. It's got a, come from Germany, it's got a swastika on it. Oh, they call that, that's your, when you get out of the service, they call that a ruptured duck.
What does that mean?
Well, that's ego means you got a discharge from the service.
Okay.
Well, we got back to the States. We landed in Boston, and about evening, they got on the ship, on the train to go to in a town, and they turned the lights on. Every one of us pretty near dived under a seat because, what you doing? Turn the lights on. We forgot he was used to it. He went 2-3 years with just no lights at all, and all of a sudden, he was driving, everybody driving by cars, and lights on, the train was all lit up. It really scared the heck out of us. I went all the way to Sioux Falls in a train. Then they thought the war was going to get over, so they sent me another 15 days. And we loaded up and went to Minneapolis, and they said, you had to have so many points, you know, for battle stars and combat zones you've been in and days or months. And I had way more than I needed, so they gave me a discharge. I come home right away. Boy, was I happy.
Yeah.
In fact, I was working for a roads team out there in Pierre when the war in Japan ended. I've been working for them for about 4 or 5 months. Pretty happy, I tell you, to get out of service.
When you came back and had time to process it, do you think you're extra lucky? Because there's so many close calls.
No doubt about it. Had to be lucky. I was lucky at everything but poker.
After being discharged from the service in 1945, Cliff stayed in the Midwest. He met Alice Mae Anderson, and within a year, the two were married. Alice was born on a South Dakota farm in 1926. Her parents, Gilbert and Nettie Anderson, had 10 children, 7 boys and 3 girls. Shortly after their wedding, Cliff and Alice moved to a farm near Clear Lake, South Dakota, and started raising a family of their own. The couple lived there for 17 years.
Well, Esther and Grandma used to run around together. Well, I was going to go to a dance in White, I think. So I rode down with him. And Esther still brings it up on the way home. I said, who was that girl? I said, why? And I said, I got to get to know her better. Well, Diane was the first one. She's born in Hendricks. Then Myron, he's born in Watertown. Then they built a new hospital in Clear Lake, and we was only 7 miles from there. So both Dennis and Neil were born in Clear Lake. Diane just got out of high school and she went to Omaha and went to, what kind of school was it? She wasn't done with school yet when they come and hired her for telephone. And she stayed with that for 30 some years. She got retired in the telephone company. And now they live in Phoenix. They got one daughter and she's got one daughter. So one there. Of course, Myron. When we left the Hydewood, he'd been in grade school all 8 years by himself. And he went to Clear Lake to school, and he got so nervous, he got sick every morning, he'd run over and throw up. So he wanted to quit. We talked him to staying there till Christmas time, and by that time he got to liking it. He never did quit going to school. He went through Brookings as far as he could, and then he went to Minneapolis. He went to the end of that. He stayed there until he got a doctor's degree. And then I told him, I said, Myron, you're going to have to quit and go to work. You'd be drawing Social Security before you got a job. Then
he's an epidemiologist.
Epidemiologist. Yeah. When he came home to service, he went to work in the road outfit. And he's working on those bridges east out of Brookings. Tom Grant and him were together and just tried to get in the police force. So they both joined up. Well, I got wound up that they both got a job in the police force. They were patrol officers there for 15 years, I think. In the meantime, Dennis got the chief of police job. And then from then on, you think he stayed there till he retired. Yeah, Neil, he went as far as he could in Brookings, didn't he? Mm-hmm. And he went to St. Cloud. He's going to school there, and his outfit's coming, wanted to try him out. And he went to work in Minneapolis when he's still going to school. And he's been there ever since, ain't he? When he started, they had how many, 200 and some guys in his outfit? And now he's got pretty that many guys under him.
And then you got these grandchildren and great-grandchildren.
Yeah. Yeah, look what I started up there. That was just Mom and I.
How many grandkids do you have?
10.
I said she got 11, she says 10.
You counting somebody twice?
I'm counting one in Ireland.
Oh. What? What?
Been fortunate to have a lot of friends, and then the kids, they act like they, well, that's been 20 years ago or so. They're all married, most of them, and got children of their own, you know? Mm-hmm. And but they still remember us, you know? Mm-hmm. And I think we remember them the same way, you know, so.
Yeah. This town, I mean, everybody in town knows you guys, right? Safe to say?
I think so.
Only can tell you right where we lived.
Only the new ones that moved in. Yeah. Nobody gets to know them.
Mm-hmm. Gosh, we had that grocery store for...
Yeah, we had the grocery store for 13 years.
Talk about the grocery store a little bit.
The grocery store?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, it was an old building, you know, so... wood floors, and we stacked groceries on shelves, you know, in the middle and in the sides. And we had met a lot of people that way too, though, you know. Mm-hmm. And that is so nice, you know. Yeah, mm-hmm. Really is. Yeah.
And you spent a lot of time at the church.
Yes, I do.
McGonagher Lutheran.
Yes, mm-hmm. McGonagher Lutheran Church. Yes, I do. I'm slowing down a little bit though, so I don't do as much as I used to do.
But okay.
I just pick and choose now what I want to do.
There you go. You guys do a cookbook every year, right?
Pardon?
Do you still do the cookbook?
We haven't made it for a while. We should. But, they talk about it. But I don't think it done or not. So.
You still make quilts.
Oh, yeah, we make quilts.
You still do that? You still sew?
Yeah. You know what? I still have that. The one I wanted to give to you is a black and white with the butterflies on yellow. Do you remember that one?
Yeah.
I would hope to get that done. So,
yeah. I'll still take it.
You'll still take it. Well, that would be nice if I would, though, because then you'd have something to keep.
So what do you make the quilts for?
Well, we do for Lutheran World Relief, and then we like the people who live at that advance, we give some to them, and we give some to the abused shelter. We give some to the Indians reservations. So we do a lot with our quilts, and we give our seniors quilts every year. A senior graduates.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
That's very sweet. I love that.
Yeah. They get to come down to church. We hang them on the back of the pews, and then they can pick and choose what they want to for that. So that's kind of interesting.
Do you get offended if they don't pick your quilt right away?
Much help?
Do you get offended if they don't pick yours first?
Well, I didn't see what they took. I couldn't remember where it was.
I'm sure they loved it no matter.
Yeah.
Is there anything you want to say about the Toronto or living here or your family or anything?
Family didn't stay around here too long after they got out of high school and college, did they?
Mm-hmm.
And like you weren't around here so long either. Well, you were in Brookings,
You got a family of movers and shakers, though. You got family that likes to move around.
Yeah, I think they do.
Well,
yeah.
Anything else? Right.
No, I can't think of anything else. Okay.
Thank you for, I know you're...
Yeah.
Throat hurts.
Yeah. So. Oh, that's so squeaky, but I don't know. It feels kind of funny.
But you look good.
Yeah.
That's what matters.
It'll make you nervous. Oh, I don't know about that, but,
Cliff and Alice Falken have lived the events that most of us will only read about in textbooks. Lucky Lindy's transatlantic flight, the Hindenburg disaster, the Great Depression, the Dust Bowl, enriching enough uranium for an atom bomb, the Civil Rights Movement, the Watergate scandal, the rise and fall of the Berlin Wall, 9/11 and the fall of the Twin Towers, November of 2008 saw America's first African-American president. The assassinations of Dr. King, John F. Kennedy, Robert Kennedy, and the Beatle John Lennon. The invention of television, microwaves, washing machines, cell phones, and the internet. This country has come a long way in the past 100 years. Thanks to people like my grandma and my grandpa.